Okay, good morning, everyone. Welcome to City View. Welcome to everyone that's here live and in person, and welcome to everyone that's tuned in online. You're watching online. Thank you. Thank you for being with us today. We're here to praise Jesus and lift up his name. He's done great things. Dallas, lead us in worship.
Amen, amen. Well, he has done great things, and we just had our kids learning about how mighty God is. And, you know, as adults, we need to remember that God does great things for us. He's the hero of our lives, amen, and we give him praise today for that. Thank you, Lord, for everything that you're doing in our lives. We just want to lift up whatever it was that happened this week. Just give it to him. Just give that all to him as we sing. That he conquered the grave, he freed every captive, he breaks every chain, amen. Amen. Here we go. Thank you. just give him some praise today. Thank you, Lord. Amen. He is our hero. He's our deliverer. Amen. And his name has power. Thank you, Jesus. To the darkness, you're the only right among the wrong, you're the only hope among the chaos, you are the voice that calls me on, louder than every lie, my sword in every fight, the truth will chase away the night. Come on, sing it with us, your name is. Your name is power over darkness, freedom for the captive, mercy for the broken and the hopeless. Your name is faithful in the battle, glory in the struggle. Chorus together. Your name is power, freedom for the captives, mercy for the broken.
Your name is power for the darkness, freedom for the captives, mercy for the broken and the hopeless. Your name is faithful in the battle, glory in the struggle.
Power. Is
His name is power. Your name is power. Your name is power.
Thank you, Father.
Your love for me, Kenyans, why?
About the words to this song, that canyons wide, oceans deep. If you've ever been to a place like the Grand Canyon and looked across it, His love's wider than that. When you think about the Laurentian Abyss, the deepest place on earth, we haven't even been able to go there as people. He's deeper than that. As it says in that bridge, beyond the stars, to the very breath I breathe, there's no end to your love for me. Amen. Beyond the stars. What's beyond the stars? We don't even know. To try to put that in your little brain is challenging. To think, what is beyond the stars? What's out there is God. It's His love. It's eternity. It's whatever God created past the stars. Amen. But His love exceeds what we can see. It exceeds what we know. There's no end to His love for you. Amen. Where could you ever run? How far could you try to get away from Him? That He wouldn't be able to bring you back, that He wouldn't be able to find you. There's no place on this earth, there's no place that you can go where He doesn't see you, He doesn't love you, He doesn't care for you. And maybe you're at an all-time low today. Maybe you're at an all-time high. Life's good, no big deal. But maybe you're coming in today, or maybe you're watching online. Life's been tough the last little while. Or maybe you've made some mistakes and you haven't prioritized your faith the way you wanted to. That's okay. But what are you going to do about it now? We know His love reaches that far for you. It's time to reach back, amen? It's time for our cities and our provinces and our countries to start reaching back to God. It's time for the family unit to stop pushing each other away and get on the same page and run towards the Father. No politician, no policy, no country leader is going to fix the world. Because what the world needs truly is Jesus. And it needs families to band together. It needs people like us, you and me, to choose to love one another. To follow the instructions that Jesus gave us. Amen. That's how we fix our world. One little person at a time. And the next song just sings about that. We've seen what He can do. He's a God of wonders, and His power has no end. no end in this world or the next, or beyond what we know. His power has no end. And there's no prison door or prison wall he can't break through, no mountain he can't move. There's no canyon he couldn't close. There's no ocean he couldn't, you know, raise, if you will. There's nothing he can't do. And in the darkest nights, he's gonna light it up. In your darkest night, he's lighting it up. He's a God of revival. He's gonna revive that in your heart today and in our cities today. See what you can do, God of wonders. Your power has no end. The things you've done before, in greater measure, you will do again. Come on, sing with me. There's no prison.
There's no prison wall you can't break through. No mountain you can move, oh, things are possible.
There's no body he can't raise.
There's no broken body you can't raise. No soul that you can't save, oh, things are possible. The darkest night, you can light it up. You can light it up. Victory, now you're seated forever on your throne.
So why should my heart?
So why should my heart fear what you've defeated? I will trust in you alone. 'Cause there's no prison wall you can't break through. No mountain you can move, oh, things are possible.
There's no broken body.
There's no broken body you can raise. No soul that you can save. Oh, things are possible. The darkest night, you can light it up. You can light it up.
To sing this over our city today, over our church, over our communities, amen. Say, come awaken.
Come awaken your people. Come awaken the city. Oh God of revival, pour it out, pour it out. And every stronghold will crumble. Our huge chest is the ground. Oh God, every Bible, pour it out, pour it out. Come awaken your people, come awaken your city. Oh God, every Bible, pour it out, every stronghold will crumble. I hear the chains hit the ground. Oh God, every Bible,
Father God, we thank you today that you love us so much. And Father, we thank you and we give you praise for the revival that you're doing in our hearts. And Lord, as we align our hearts with your heart, Lord, as we align our purposes and plans with those that you have for us, Father, I just pray that every one of us would just experience your love in a powerful, powerful way, Lord. Father, I thank you that there's no circumstances, there's no walls, there's no nothing, nothing in our past can keep us from your love. And so, Father, we just receive from you today that love, that grace, that peace, that strength that we need. And Father, we just put our trust in you, Lord. And even though the world might be crumbling around us in some ways, Lord, we just put our trust in you. For you are the God of miracles. You are the God of breakthroughs. You are a mighty fortress, Lord. We put our hope and our trust and our confidence in you, Lord. Lord, we continue to pray for our world and for our country and for our city, Lord. Father, break through in a supernatural way, Lord. Bring revival in places where people at one time worshiped you and honored you, but have now just fallen away and have decided that you're not important. Father, break through your Holy Spirit. Just meet them where they're at. Bring them back to that place of fellowship, that place of repentance, and that place of revival in their lives, Lord. We pray and we stand on that today, Father. Father, I thank you for the promises that you've given us, Lord. Thank you for the promise of protection. Father, we thank you and we praise you today that in all things, in every circumstance, we can put our trust in you. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Well, thank you, Dallas. Thank you, worship team, for leading us this morning. I hope that you that are watching at home were able to worship with us. There's something special about being in God's presence when we take time. And I know that you can't grasp it or touch it. And yet
presence of God is so real. You just sense it. You just feel it, right? And it is so good to be in God's presence. It's so good to be with God's people. Amen. So what a privilege we have to be together today. Well, we have been talking in 2022 about the supernatural. We talked last week about it, about living in the supernatural. Remember, we said that, number one, we need to be expecting and looking for God's supernatural in our lives. No matter where we go, no matter who we come in contact with, no matter what the circumstance is, there is a supernatural that God has for you and for us, right? And then number two, I had said, remember to keep it simple. Don't be believing for the oceans to be parted just yet, okay? You can work up to that. That's fine. And if you're at that place, go for it. But you know what? Sometimes the simple things, the small little things, are the things where we see God's supernatural hand. And, you know, we even heard a report before we started recording today. We heard a report of someone who had a supernatural report from the doctor. And, you know, it's real simple. This lady put her trust in God, and she put her trust in Jesus, the healer, and got a wonderful report from the doctor in her life. So praise God. That's a good place for you to use your faith and to be believing for the supernatural. And then number three, we said, remind yourself daily that God's supernatural is for you. It's for every one of you. There's no one that's exempt. In other words, you know, no matter who you are, no matter what you look like, no matter what your past is like, you're not exempt from God's supernatural operating in your life. He wants to operate in your life. He wants to touch you and meet you where you're at. Amen. And there was a story that I told last week. And so the boys were just helping me fill in some of the details. I don't know. Do you remember me telling the story about the young people going off to YC in the van and the sinkhole? And they said, well, Dad, you kind of made it sound like a little pothole in the road, right? So I went searching. Okay, here we got it. Okay, so if you can put that picture up there, and yes, okay, this was Lessard Road, and this sinkhole, the person in the description that I found, they estimated it was 10 feet across and almost 10 feet deep. Okay, so like this wasn't just a little bump in the road. Okay, this was a huge hole, right? And our young people, our van full of young people headed off to just celebrate Jesus and to go to YC, went and drove over this piece of road just shortly before this sinkhole appeared. And it was a big deal. The road was shut down for weeks. And the reason we're so aware of it is because where the sinkhole was, when they had to close the road, the detour, guess where the detour went? It went right by our house. So all day long, the buses and all the cars that would have been on Lessard Road were driving in front of our house. So we were very aware that that road was not operable for a period of time there, right? And, you know, I thought of another one this week when we were talking, and you talk about the supernatural. And, you know, sometimes we forget how God has moved, even in our midst as a church. But there was a lady who came to our church a few years ago, and she had been diagnosed with leukemia. And, you know, when she came the very first service, I remember us praying for her and standing with her and praying. And it's like, this is not for God. We need to stand and agree for healing for your body. And, you know, that lady is still, she's still a part of our church, even to this day, and continues to get, you know, reports from the doctor. It seems like every time she goes to the doctor, she would come back and say, well, my blood is better and I'm healthier and I'm stronger. And just God, you know, it wasn't an overnight thing. She didn't just walk in and the next day she was totally healed. But you know what? It was one of those progressive miracles, but it's still just as supernatural. It's supernatural to be told that you have leukemia and the potential is that you could die. And yet years later, you're still walking and living for God because you put your trust in Him. Amen. And so today, the title of my message today, I want to kind of just take one step maybe further or tie it together with the whole supernatural aspect. But the title of my message today is Fight or Flight. Okay, we've all heard the expression, right? Fight or flight. Some people like to, you know, they'll just put up their fists and get ready for the fight, and other people just run. Amen. And, you know, as I was praying this week and just seeking God today, He reminded me that there is a spiritual principle that is at work, and it's actually unfolding before our eyes. I don't know if there's anybody that didn't watch any news from last Sunday to this Sunday, okay? If you didn't, then you're not going to know what I'm talking about. But if you did happen to turn the TV on at all, you see a situation unfolding, and the whole situation with the Ukraine, and I mean, we're praying and interceding for these people, but you know what? We have to pray for people on both sides. We have to pray for the Russian people as well. We have to pray for the Ukrainian people. But here's what I saw. I saw like two primary groups of people. There were those that said, I'm going to fight. I'm going to fight for my country. And there were civilians, untrained people. It was just like, give me a gun and show me how to shoot it, and I'm going to fight. I'm going to fight for my country. I'm going to fight for our freedoms, right? But then at the same time, and this is not a judgmental thing, but there were people that are fleeing the country. I mean, they couldn't get out fast enough. They were headed, you know, we saw them lined up at the borders and just exiting because they were concerned about their country and are concerned about their safety. And so we see these two attitudes or two perspectives that are developing in that. And you know what? Here's what God reminded me is that, you know what? It's the same for us as believers. You know, every day we are engaged in a battle. And whether we like it or not, we have been invaded. Our territory, our world has been invaded by a demonic force. We call him Satan. We call him the devil sometimes. And he's come in and he's here to steal and to kill and to destroy. He wants to steal. He wants to take territory. He wants to see defeated Christians defeated in their lives. He wants to see us give in to temptations. He wants to see us abandon our faith and not put our trust in God. And you know, as much as we watch the people in horror, just devastated by these attacks, missiles and tanks and military oppression, you know what? We as believers face the same kind of opposition, but it's maybe not in the natural. Now, I know in the Ukraine, there are a lot of believers. There are a lot of Christians. Gene and I were watching Rick Renner this week, and he was sharing how there are thousands and thousands of Bible-believing, probably tongue-talking, spirit-filled Christians who are in the Ukraine. And those people, they are facing a physical war. They are in a warfare that is on a physical level. But you know what? We have to realize that we are engaged in a warfare too, but it's on a spiritual level. And we may not see it. Nobody might come through the door today with guns and ammunition and things like that. But we're still involved in a spiritual warfare. And the question today is, are we going to fight or are we going to flight? Are we going to run for it or are we going to stay and take the enemy and face him head on? Now, first of all, the first point that I need to make is this. We have an enemy, okay? A lot of people, you know, I love my heritage. I love the people where I grew up, the church that I grew up in. But you know what? They didn't talk about the fact that we had an enemy too much, okay? It was kind of out there somewhere. But I didn't see Satan or the devil as being someone who was after me and wanted to get me off of living for Jesus, right? I just never identified that. And so sometimes, let me read a verse first, and then I'll say what I was going to say. Let's go to 1 Peter and chapter 5 and verse 8. So if you have your Bible, turn to 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 8. 1 Peter 5 and 8 says this in the New International. It says, "Be alert and of sober mind." In other words, like, hello, you know, pay attention. Like if this was Back to the Future, you know, remember, I don't know if anybody remembers Back to the Future, remember, you know, and Biff took his cane, you know, and he bopped Marty on the head and said, "Hello, McFly, anybody home?" Right? Well, so that's what this, if I translated this verse, that would be, "Hello, anybody home? Hello, pay attention. Be alert and of a sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour." Okay. If you don't realize that you have an enemy, you're not going to see him coming, right? You're not going to know where the enemy is coming to get you off of the place of victory that God has established you or promised for you, right? And it's important to understand. I remember growing up and my mom was the most sincere, you know, believer. She was sold out for God, but she had one fault, if you will, and that was, it was like, well, I'm sure that things are all going to work out. You know, I'm sure God has a plan. Well, guess what? You know, sometimes it's just the enemy trying to get us in fear or get us into defeat in our lives. And you know what? We need to just realize we have an enemy. If you don't recognize that you have an enemy, you know, it's the old story, right? The company, and you see this every once in a while, you'll see a company that someone's been convicted. You know, it's usually like the CEO or maybe the accountant or whoever, and they've been convicted of embezzling a whole bunch of money over the years from the company. And sometimes it's an astounding amount of money that they've stolen from these companies. But the problem is, if you don't realize that they're taking from you, like, well, yeah, they could take from you forever. And if they're never caught, like how do you know, right? You just think, oh, well, you know, business carries on. Meanwhile, this person's skimming. Well, that's like the enemy. Satan comes and he's skimming off the top. He's skimming on when we're saying, well, you know, I just got to trust God and maybe circumstances didn't work out this time. But you know what? We need to recognize when the enemy has it in for us, when he's after us, and when he wants to try and defeat us in our lives. This is a critical point. And the sad reality is that many Christians are attributing things to God. It's like, well, you know, all these things went wrong in my life. Maybe God had some special purpose. Maybe he wants to work it out for his good. And so they quote that all things work together for good. Yeah, all things work together for good. But we can't oblivious to the fact that we have an enemy. Amen. So here's the question. Is this where you find yourself today? You know, we fit into different groups. People are at different places in their walk of faith. And, you know, there are people that maybe this is a new concept. The idea that there is an enemy and that he is after you and he wants to cause trouble in your life and he wants to get you from faith into fear. You know, maybe that's a new concept to you. But I'm telling you, the Bible supports it, and it talks a lot about the enemy, and it talks about a lot. Let me go back to the verse again. Be alert and have a sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. He is out to devour Christians. But if we realize we have an enemy, then we start to see him coming, and that's where number two comes in. Number two point that I want to make today is this. It's an uneven battle, okay? Or another way to say it is, it's not a fair fight, okay? And when I say that, I'm not talking about that the devil is so big that he can get us. I'm talking about that my God is so big that the devil is nothing. He is nothing compared to the greatness of our God. And, you know, we even in the songs that we're singing today in worship, right? Like, our God is so much greater. God is infinitely greater than anything that the enemy can in our lives, right? And it's only when we get our eyes focused on him and not focused on the greatness and the goodness of our God that we start to see, you know, the battle from a different perspective, right? I go back to the story of David and Goliath, and we use David and Goliath so many times, but it's just such a simple example of where in the natural, Goliath was like, you know, 8 feet tall. He was a huge dude, okay? And he was there and he had a big sword and a big shield and he was ready to take on anybody in the natural. But here's little David, the shepherd boy, comes along and he's got his stones and he, you know what David says? I just love this. You know, if God be for us, who dare be against us? That's what we need to say when we're faced with things in life. If God is for us, if God is for you, if God is for me, who would dare come against us, right? And when we have that kind of attitude, then we start putting the enemy in his place. It's like, I am not going to believe your lies. I am not going to believe this bad report. I'm not going to give in to this fear in this situation. I am going to put my trust in God, because if God be for us, who dare be against us? And you know what? We need to be led by the Holy Spirit in these things. You know, David had a revelation from God. You know, David didn't just come up and say, well, you know, I've been practicing throwing stones. Let's give it a try on this big old Goliath here, right? No, David spent time with God. When he'd be out with the sheep, he'd be worshiping. That's why so many of the Psalms, they're really songs that David wrote, right? He was singing. He was a worshiper. He loved to be in God's presence. And when you're in God's presence like that, and this, I mean, I'll just say it. When you are in God's presence, when you spend time in His presence, He gives you the revelation for your situation. He helps you see the things where the enemy is coming in, where he wants to get you defeated, right? And so when we are led by the Holy Spirit, then we're going to be in God's perfect place in our lives. We're going to see and hear His voice, right? And I wrote in my notes, we need to be led by the Holy Spirit, not led by what we see on CNN or anything else that might be influencing us, right? You know, I have said it before, and I'm not trying to be critical of the news or the media, but you know what? If all I listened to was that, boy, I wouldn't have the faith to face a lot of the things that I have to face in life. I've got to be focused on God. I've got to be focused on His Word. I've got to be focused on the things and the promises that He has for me. Here's the verse. Let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 10. I looked at this one in a couple different translations, and I chose the Phillips today, okay? Phillips translation. And so 2 Corinthians chapter 10, beginning at verse 3, says this, "The truth is that although, of course, we lead a normal human lives, the battle we are fighting is on a spiritual level. The very weapons we use are not those of human warfare, but powerful in God's warfare for the destruction of the enemy's strongholds." That's what we want, amen? We want to see the enemy defeated. We want to see his strongholds in our lives. And maybe, you know, maybe you are facing a stronghold today. Maybe there's something that's got a grip on you. It's got a grip on your heart, or got a grip on your body, or got a grip on your family, or it's got a grip on your finances. These are strongholds that the enemy uses to get us defeated. But you know what? The warfare that we're facing, we have God's powerful weapons, and they are strong for the destruction of the enemy's strongholds. Let me keep going. Our battle is to bring down every deceptive fantasy and every imposing defense that men erect against the true knowledge of God. And there's the word of caution, right? Be careful what people say to you. It's good to listen to the Holy Spirit. You know, and there's nothing wrong with listening to, you know, what men say. Sometimes men have real wonderful godly wisdom, but sometimes they just have natural wisdom. And we need to get God's wisdom. And we need to line it up. And if what someone is saying to me, if someone, the advice that somebody's giving me, and I talked about that last week, that, you know, there were situations where, you know, people gave me natural, and it was good advice in the norm, in every situation. You couldn't say it wasn't good advice. The problem was it wasn't Holy Spirit. And I need to be led by the Holy Spirit in order to know how to interpret the situation and know that, yeah, there might be a spiritual battle going on, and all I'm seeing is the natural signs, the natural symptoms, the natural results. But God wants us to be operating in the spiritual, right? And we even fight to capture every thought until it acknowledges the authority of Christ. You know what? There is an authority that has been given in Jesus. And guess what? That authority has been given to us. And when we rise up with that authority, and this is a case of fight or flight, you know, do we turn and run when something happens that is not, when we get the bad report, when something comes in our lives, and it's like, whoa, okay, I'm not sure how I'm going to handle this one. You know, do we run and hide? Do we, you know, are we like the ostriches that bury our head in the ground? Or do we say, no, wait, God has given us authority. There is an authority that comes from being in Christ Jesus. You know, you are in Christ Jesus. Every one of us are in Christ Jesus. Because of Jesus' blood, because of what He did on the cross, we are made the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And so when we take that authority and we realize that authority, then we become victors. We start to see ourselves as the victors, not the victims, right? And so the question today is, do you wrestle with this aspect? Do you wrestle with the fact that we have been given authority to see the victory in this spiritual realm? Where is your battle today? Where is the battle that you're facing? Is it an impossible healing situation? Is it some kind of maybe a major career or work situation? Is it a family breakdown or a marriage situation? Is it some kind of financial stress or challenge? Here's the thing. We need to see these as battles that can be won in the spirit realm. God has promised that we will overcome. He has promised that we have authority. But if we try and sometimes fight these battles in the natural, sometimes we get nowhere. I know Pastor Gene and I won't cite examples because that doesn't help anything. But there have been situations where we tried and tried and tried to deal with something in the natural. But then when we got in our kitchen, I remember us a few times just getting in the kitchen and saying, God, we're going to put our trust in you. And we started jumping up and down and rejoicing. The circumstances hadn't changed yet. But we stood on the promises of God, and we knew that we would win in the spirit realm first, and then we'd see it in the natural realm. And so we started rejoicing and saying, thank you, God, that we have the victory. Thank you that we have the breakthrough. Thank you that we have the answer. Thank you that we have the provision. Thank you, thank you, thank you. That is where we change from battling in the natural to battling in the spirit realm, right? Now, sometimes there are things that come up and we need to know where we're anchored. We need to know what is our place of safety, the thing that is a stronghold, the thing that we can hang on to. And that reminds me of the story. Now, Pastor Jean, for those of you that are watching online, she already referenced this with the children, but I went one better. I got pictures. Can you put the pictures up there? Okay. The date, if I'm not mistaken, was January the 19th of 2021. This is 1 year ago. Okay, so I'll just set it up for you. We're in the middle of remember the real lockdowns right around Christmas time last year, and we weren't supposed to be anywhere. We weren't supposed to have family things, right? But, you're allowed to meet outside, okay? And you can have a family gathering outside. So that's what we did. And Donovan graciously built a wonderful fire, as you can see in the one picture there. And so we all got together on the deck at Donovan's house, right? Because we were going to be, follow the rules and stay outside, right? Well, we're having a merry time there. And as you can see, that's a pretty good fire Donovan got going there, right? And he put that little gate thing up. To protect the kids so they wouldn't get too close to the fire. And we were going to roast some marshmallows and stuff, and we're out there. And all of a sudden, this wind comes. And the wind comes up, and it starts blowing everything all over the place. There's sparks were flying from the fire. That fence that you see in the picture, it was flying across the whole yard. Literally, it was we had to grab it, it was taken off. All the stuff that was there, the lawn chairs were flying across the yard. And I thought we were going to see stuff going over the fence because the wind was that strong coming. And the kids have one of those little playground sets, with the steps and the little slide that comes down and everything. That playground set was literally being blown right across the grass. So Donovan yells to me, he says, hang on to something. And so I grabbed that gate thing that was around the fire. I grabbed the playground set. Otherwise, it was taken off across the yard, and I'm hanging on to things. And he's just started latching everything down, tying everything down. And Gene and Calla took the kids in. They went in. I still remember Ella and Louie, it was. I still remember Ella and Louie. They're standing on the patio with their noses against the glass, looking out at this chaos that's blowing in the backyard, and Donovan and I are trying to tie things down so they wouldn't all blow away, right? Well, here's the point. Sometimes we find ourselves in the storm, but you know what? If we know where to latch on, and if we know what to grab a hold of in the middle of the storm. I'm not saying the storms don't come. The storms do come in life. I know, even as I look around with the faces that are here, and I know some of you that are watching online, I know some of the storms that you've faced, some of the storms that have come up. But you know what? We put our trust in God. And the battle, again, is not in the natural. It is in the supernatural, where we put our trust in God. When you put your trust in God, it's like locking those things down. It's like driving a solid peg into the ground that's going to hold that playground set so it doesn't take off. And that's what we need to do when we find ourselves in the middle of the storm. Remember what to grab onto. If we feel blown away by the circumstances, instead of running to hide, we need to hang on to the rock that is more solid than anything. And here's the scripture that comes to my mind. It's Psalm 62. It was David. And he said this. I'll read it. Psalm 62 and verses 1 and 2 in the New International says this: "Truly my soul finds rest in God. My salvation comes from Him. Truly He is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress and I will never be shaken." We will not be blown away. We will not be like all the stuff, our cookies. We had a whole tin of cookies we had just opened. They were sitting on the beside the fire. They all got like upended. There was cookies everywhere in the whole snowbank, right? We won't be like that. We'll be solid because we're founded in the rock. Our rock is Jesus, and our salvation is in God. When we put our trust in Him and what He has done for us, we will never be shaken. And my third point today, and I close with this, is that we need to remember the rules of engagement. When we're involved in warfare, and I remember years ago, the boys and I watched this movie, and I don't know if Gene watched it or not, but it was about some military guys, and they had gone into another country. They found themselves surrounded by the enemy, okay? And we see this kind of thing happening in the Ukraine, right? People are surrounded by the enemy. But There's rules of engagement, right? And you know what? When we're facing a spiritual battle in our lives, there are rules of engagement. It's not a natural battle. It is a supernatural battle. And we need to use the supernatural weapons that we've been given. Okay, so let's go to Ephesians 6. And we're going to read this. And this is, I know it's a familiar passage of scripture. So I picked the New Living Translation because you may not have read it in New Living. But let's just see what God has to say for us today about fighting the battle in the spirit realm, okay? Paul says this when writing to the Ephesians church, chapter 6, verse 10, a final word: be strong in the Lord and in His mighty power, okay? We can try and do it in our own strength, but it is in His mighty power. Verse 11, put on all of God's armor, so that you will be able to stand firm against the strategies of the devil. For we are not fighting against flesh and blood enemies, but against evil rulers and authorities of the unseen world, against mighty powers in this dark world, and against evil spirits in heavenly places. Okay, think about that for a second. Just pause and think about that. It is a spiritual battle. And when we find ourselves, and no matter what we're facing, when we find ourselves under some kind of oppression, when we find ourselves in a battle, just remember that we are not fighting natural. You know, we love to use this example in marriage, right? You know, when a husband and wife are locking horns over stuff, we always say, whoa, stop. Remember, you know, it's not a natural battle here, okay? We need to be fighting it in the spirit realm. You're going to get the breakthroughs in your marriage, and you're going to get the breakthroughs in your family and in your life when you realize that it is spiritual forces that are coming against us that want to steal and kill and destroy in our lives. Let's carry on. Verse 13, therefore put on every piece of God's armor. When I read this, I think Dallas preached a message back in fall. You can go back and look at it. It'll still be on YouTube. And he preached about the armor of God, right? Therefore, put on every piece of God's armor so you'll be able to resist the enemy in the time of evil. And then after the battle, you will be still standing firm. That's what we want to be, right? Even after the battle, even after the enemy has tried everything he can try, we want to be standing firm. Verse 14, stand your ground, putting on the belt of truth and the body armor of God's righteousness. For shoes, put on the peace that comes from the good news, so that you will be fully prepared. In addition to all of these things, hold up the shield of faith to stop the fiery arrows of the devil, and put on salvation as your helmet, and take the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. I always love to stop and emphasize the sword, which is the offensive weapon in all of this, right? Is what? It's the Word of God. That's why we say always over and over and over, speak the Word of God over your situation. You know, when you are doing warfare in the spirit realm, you need to be speaking the Word. You can't use your human natural wisdom. You've got to be speaking God's Word. Because remember, God's Word in your mouth holds the same power and authority as it would if God Himself was speaking it over you and over your situation. You take His Word and all of a sudden all of the power and authority of the name of Jesus and all of the power and authority that comes from God is released into your situation when you are speaking God's Word. Then verse 18, pray in the Spirit at all times and on every occasion. I love that. Yeah, that's a whole sermon all in itself, right? Pray in the Spirit at all times and on every occasion. So when am I supposed to pray in the Spirit? All times. Everybody say all. And on how many occasions? Every occasion. It's that, you know what? There isn't a circumstance that comes in our lives where we can't, like, we can just stop and pray in the Spirit, right? And that aligns our heart with God's heart for that, right? The verse goes on to say, stay alert and be persistent in your prayers for all believers everywhere. We need to be praying. We need to be praying for each other. We need to be praying for the people in Ukraine. We need to be praying for the leadership of our nations. You know, I said to Pastor Gene, I said, you know, think about it. Here's Ukraine. They don't have a big military force, right? It's a fairly large country and whatever it is, 44 million people or something live there. But you know what? They never expected that if they were faced with some opposition, that they would be left high and dry to fight the battle by themselves. They always thought, oh, well, our allies will come to our defense. They'll help us out. You know, think about it. We're in Canada here. I mean, our military, yes, we have good military, but it's nothing compared to the military of the U.S. So if somebody was to invade Canada, you know, we've always said, I mean, my whole life, we've just grown up knowing, oh, well, if anything ever happened to Canada, the U.S. would come to help us out. But guess what? What if they didn't? And that's what happened with the Ukraine, right? Here they were counting on all their allies to come to their defense. And meanwhile, they're at the bargaining table saying, should we come to their defense? Should we help them out? Should we send the planes? We don't want to start a nuclear war. All of this stuff that's going on. I'll tell you, they need wisdom and they need us to be praying for them. And sure, the verse says to pray for believers everywhere, but we need to be praying for everyone. There are a lot of believers in the Ukraine. There are a lot of believers in all those other countries. You know, listening to Rick Renner, there are thousands of believers. I mean, he has a huge church in Moscow, right? Moscow, of all places, right? They do, I think he said 7 services on a Sunday. That's how big their church is. They go through 7 services on a Sunday in order to accommodate everybody that comes to church. Well, we need to be praying for these people. We need to be praying for these countries. We need to be praying for resolve there. Well, let me finish this passage. And then he says in verse 19, and pray for me too. Boy, can I just say, can you pray for me too? I pray for you. I hope you pray for us. I hope you pray for Pastor Gene and I, because we need your prayers. Ask God to give me the right words that I can, so I can boldly explain God's mysterious plan, and that the good news is for Jews and Gentiles alike. And this is Paul speaking. I'm in chains now, still preaching this message as God's ambassador, but pray that I will keep on speaking boldly for Him as I should. So what does God's word say about your battle? What are you trusting Him for today? Are you involved in a battle? Is it a spiritual battle or is it a natural battle? Are you trying to fight a spiritual battle with natural weapons? Well, guess what? You can go all day long. And Goliath found out real fast that the natural weapons don't do you any good when God's supernatural is involved, right? And that's what happened when David came with those little stones. Those stones were anointed. they went exactly where they needed to do the job and to to put the enemy in his place. So I want to encourage you today to spend time. Spend time in God's presence. Spend time in His Word. Spend time praying and getting the wisdom from God that you need for your situation. God has promised the victory, but we are faced with a choice. Are we going to fight and see the victory, or are we going to flight? Are we going to run, right? It is not a natural battle, and we don't win with natural weapons. It's a spiritual battle that we win by using our faith in God and putting our trust in God. So here's my question as I end. Which statement describes you when faced with a spiritual battle? Which this would be the words out of your mouth? Head for the hills, Betsy! Would that be your, or are you never, never, never give up? Which statement would be you? I believe that we can win in every situation. And sometimes the battle seems overwhelming. But you know what? God wants to see us break through. He has a destiny for every one of us. There's a purpose and a plan for your life. There is a destiny for you. And the things that you've gone through, maybe you've had some defeats. Maybe there have been some hard things. Maybe there have been some circumstances that came that were impossible. But you know what? God wants to restore. He wants to heal your heart. He wants to heal your situation. And He wants you to bring you to a place of victory in your life. And so the same way that we would stand in faith, we stand for those engaged in spiritual battles around us. As believers, we have an opportunity to touch, to minister to each other, to encourage each other, to stand with each other, to see the breakthroughs. Amen. And that is a privilege that we've been given. And yes, we need to pray for our world. We need to pray for our nation. We need to pray for our leaders. And we need to pray for these world events that are taking place. I don't know if what's happening currently, I don't have any direct revelation on this, if what's happening currently is a part of Bible prophecy, but I do know that the Bible says to watch for wars and rumors of wars. Well, this ain't a rumor. This is a real war. This is the real deal. And, you know, whatever is happening, we need to pray. We need to pray for those people, but we need to be praying for God to direct us too as He prepares our hearts. Amen. And you know what? We're going to go into time of communion. I hope for those of you that are with us today that you picked up some communion elements on the way in. I'm going to invite Pastor Gene to join me here. And if, Mike, do you want to bring your mic? Yeah. If you didn't get communion, just slip out and grab some. Pretty soon, I think we're going to go back to handing out the communion elements. I think we've followed COVID protocols where everybody serves themselves long enough. It's time for us to do things that, you know, it's a privilege. It's a privilege to be able to have and receive communion together here. And it's a privilege, and I just want us as believers to be able to just recognize what this means in our lives, right? We've been talking about being involved in spiritual warfare. I'll tell you what. We are winners. Why? Because of what Jesus did on the cross. And there are two things that I'm reminded of, and I picked the modern English version today to read the passage of Scripture that we normally read. It's in 1 Corinthians 11, if you want to look there. 1 Corinthians 11. Verse 23, and it says, I have received of the Lord that which I delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night He was betrayed, He took bread. And so, first of all, we take the bread. It's a little wafer that's for those of us here with these. It's on the top. When He had given thanks, He broke it and He said, take and eat. This is My body, which is broken for you. You stop and think about that. He was talking to His disciples. This was prophetic. It hadn't happened yet. But He was saying, My body is broken for you. Why did His body need to be broken? For one reason, to bring healing for us, right? It is by His stripes that we are healed. It is through His broken body that we can claim healing and health. And you know what? That's what we do first. So let's take the wafer together. And as we receive it, we thank you, Jesus, that you laid down your life, that you were willing to have your body broken for us, that you took in your body those stripes so that we could be healed. And so, Father, we take this communion wafer today as a remembrance of your body being broken for us. We just declare, I declare right now, even as we take this, I declare healing over every person here and every person watching online. It is by Jesus' stripes that you are healed, and I believe that as you take this wafer today, that the healing power of God will be poured out in your life, that whatever you are believing for, I'm believing and declaring that it will be manifest, that you will see that healing miracle, that healing breakthrough. So let's take the wafer together in remembrance of Christ's body.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written, and Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Jesus, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Jesus. Jesus Christ, our living hope. You know, it says in that same passage in 1 Corinthians 11, it says in verse 25, in the same manner, he took the cup, and after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Those disciples knew. They knew what a covenant was. Sometimes we don't understand covenant fully like they did. They lived under it. They lived under a covenant. They lived under an Old Testament covenant. But Jesus was declaring, this cup represents my blood, which will seal a new covenant. All of the things that I talked about today, all the things we talked about last week, the supernatural, the breakthroughs, doing warfare in the spirit realm and seeing the victories in the spirit realm, where we see the victory first in the spirit realm and then we see it in the natural. All of those things are ours because of the blood of Jesus, because of the covenant that we have, because Jesus gave his life for us. So let's take the juice together and remember the blood that Jesus shed for us.
Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. In Jesus Christ, my living hope. And hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip. This salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, I live in hope.
Hallelujah, Jesus. For those of you that are here, why don't you stand up with us? And we're just going to ask Dallas to sing that once more. But I want you to grab a hold of it. And like, Yeah, grab a hold in the natural, but you know what? It's a spiritual thing. Whatever you're believing for, God, today, whatever the battle is that you are facing, let's just receive by faith today. Just say, Father, I receive it in Jesus' name. It is mine. I grab hold of it by faith. I claim it as mine. Yes.
And actually just start speaking to whatever the mountain is. Yeah, start speaking to it right where
that's
you
good.
Are.
That's
if
good.
It's a physical thing, lay your yes. hand on where the pain is, whatever it is, you take authority. If it's something in your mind, you start speaking to that. If it's a relationship thing, put your hand on your heart and start claiming what you're believing for. Let's just do that as we sing this last song. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father.
Jesus, God.
Just going to sing the chorus. Yeah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. I feel like I can't not sing the third verse.
Okay.
We've been singing.
All right.
Go for it.
Why don't you just pray as I sing this?
Then came the morning that sealed the promise.
Yes, Jesus.
Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. 'Cause hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. 'Cause hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. In Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh God, you are my living hope.
We just thank you now, Father God. We thank you for victory. We thank you that the enemy is under our feet. He is defeated. Thank you, Father God, for your blood that brought the victory, Father. We will continue to say with our mouths what we are believing for. We will speak to that mountain and declare that it must come down in Jesus' name. And we just thank you, Father. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus, that we have the hope, Father, that so many don't. And we just pray now this week that as we go out, God, we will be remembering our God is so big, so strong, and so mighty.
Yes.
There's nothing our God cannot do.
Yes.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Yes.
Amen. Jesus. Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Want to thank those of you that have joined in online today. Thank you for being with us. And we are praying for you. And if you want prayer, just reach out to us. Send us an email or let us know. And we want to pray. We want to stand in agreement with you for the battles that you're facing. And for everyone here, we want to stand. We are standing in agreement with you. We are declaring that God's victory is yours. And we know that it's a spiritual battle. But we have the victory because of Jesus. So thank you again for tuning in. At City View, I want to just remind you that we want everyone at City View to discover real love and live life with purpose.
The storm was loud, but it couldn't tell me nothing. The fire was wild, but it just left me struggling. You're moving the stillness, you're moving the stillness. Closing the distance, now I can feel it. Now I can feel ya. Your voice isn't hidden, your voice isn't hidden. I just gotta listen, listen.
I hear you whispering, can you close? Close, close, I hear you whispering.
looking for you, trying to find the courage to want to regret not taking the step toward my purpose. I'm waking up, taking a new perspective. The night was long until I got the message. You're moving the stillness, you're moving the stillness, closing the distance. Now I can feel it, now I can feel ya. Ooh, wow. Your voice isn't hidden, your voice isn't hidden. I just gotta listen.